Hello, this is the lecture number 17 for the chapter integration, and today we are starting with the definite integrals. Now, what is a definite integral? The definite integral has a unique value. As you have done that, indefinite integral does not have a unique value because for the same function, we can have the different integral. So the definite integral has a unique value. A definite integral is denoted by this integration sign from a to b fx with respect to x, where a is called the lower limit of the integral and b is called the upper limit of the integral. Now the definite integral is either as a sum of the limit, which we have discussed in the last lecture, that is in exercise 7.8, or if it has a antiderivative capital F in interval ab, close interval AB, then its value is the difference between the value of the function capital X, F capital F at the end points, that is capital FB minus capital FA. Now the definite integral from A to B FX with respect to X denotes the area bounded by the curve Y is equal to FX. The coordinates are X is equal to A and X is equal to B and the X axis. Suppose this is the curve FX, which you call it by, and suppose there is a limit from x equal to a and x equal to b, then this definite integral denotes the area bounded by this curve between these two limits and x-axis when we are integrating it with respect to x, and when we are differentiating it with respect to y, then the area is bounded by the curve between these two limits along the y-axis is the area denoted by this definite integral with respect to y. Now area of the shaded region is a function of x. This is a function of x, y is equal to fx. We denoted the function by the area capital AX. Function AX is the area function, and it's given by area x from the definite integral A to B with fx with respect to x. Let f be a continuous function defined on the closed interval AB, and let capital F be the antiderivative of f. Then definite integral from a to b fx with respect to x is equal to fx from limit a to b, that is fb minus fa, denotes this definite integral. So definite integral has a unique value, and it denotes the area bounded by the curve between the two given limits and the x-axis. And this concept will be used in the chapter application directive, so be very clear about that. Now, after that, we have some properties of the definite integral. First is, if we change the variable in the definite integral, then the value of the definite integral does not change. That is, if we have the definite integral from a to b fx with respect to x, then we can write definite integral from a to b ft with respect to t. That is, we have changed the variables. Now, second property is that if we interchange the limit, then the value of the sign of the integral, definite integral, change. That is, if we have the limit from a to b, then we can write limit from b to a minus sign. You have to put it here. Now, next is if there is a limit from a to c fx with respect to x, so we can break into two or more than two integral like this, from definite integral from a to b fx with respect to x plus a b to c. That is, if b lies between a, c lies between a and b. For example, if we have the integration of x with respect to x from 1 to 3, so you can write 1 to 2 x with respect to x plus 2 to 3 x with respect to x. You can write like this. Now, after that, we have a fourth property, that is a definite integral from a to b fx with respect to x, then we in place of x we can write a plus b minus x. Now the next is fifth property is, if there is a definite integral from minus a to a fx with respect to x, then it is equal to twice 0 to a definite integral fx with respect to x if f is an even function. I'll discuss what is an even function after this property. And this integral minus a to a fx with respect to x is equal to 0 if fx is an odd function. This integral will be equal to 0 if fx is an odd function. This integral from minus a to a fx with respect to x is equal to twice the definite integral from 0 to a fx with respect to x if it is a even integral, even function. Now what is an even function? The function fx is said to be even if f minus x will be equal to fx. if f minus x is equal to fx. For example, if we have fx is equal to cos x, then f minus x means cos minus x, and cos minus x is equal to plus cos x, because minus means fourth interval and fourth quadrant. Minus x means fourth quadrant, and cos in the fourth quadrant is positive. So f minus x is equal to fx. Similarly, another example of even function is x square. Fx is equal to x square. If we replace x by minus x, so it will again will be x square, means it is an even function. Now, what is an odd function? If f minus x is equal to minus fx, then it is known as the odd function. For example, if fx is equal to sine x, so f minus x is equal to sine minus x, and sine minus x is equal to minus sine x, because in the fourth quadrant the sine is negative, so it is equal to minus fx. So it is an odd function. Another example of odd function is fx is equal to x cube. Now, if you replace x by minus x, so it will be minus x cube, means minus x ka whole cube means minus x cube, so it is equal to minus fx. So it is an odd function. Now, after that, there is a very, very important property which will be used in most of the question. That is, if there is a limit from 0 to a in the definite integral fx with respect to x, so we can replace x by a minus x, and we will prove this property. Now, what you have to prove that from 0 to a, f a minus x dx is equal to definite integral from 0 to a fx with respect to x. So I am letting a minus x is equal to t. Let a minus x is equal to t. So 0 minus dx is equal to dt. So dt is equal to minus dx. Now, when you let something, you have to change the lower limit and upper limit, because lower and upper limit is in terms of x, and because we have changed the variable from x to t, so obviously we have to change the upper limit and lower limit in terms of t. So upper limit is a minus x is equal to t, and the original upper limit is a. So when you replace x by a, so t will become 0. That is, if upper limit in terms of a in terms of x is a, then the upper limit in terms of t is equal to 0. Similarly, lower limit ax, we have let ax a minus x is equal to t, and the lower limit is 0. To replace x by 0, so it will become t is equal to minus a. T is equal to minus the upper limit is a, then the lower limit will come out to be minus a. So replace it, a minus x is equal to t, dx is minus dt, lower limit is minus a, upper limit is 0, as we have just found it out. Now it is ft dt, minus sign is here. Now if you interchange the lower limit and upper limit, the sign will change. No, so it is, I think it is equal to a. Mistake here. So change it, the lower limit is 0, a minus 0, so it will be equal to plus a, and when you replace a minus x is equal to t, dx is equal to minus dt, it is equal to plus a. When negative sign is there, when you change the lower limit with upper limit, the we have done just like it here, then the sign of the integral will change. So make 0 to the lower limit and a to the upper limit, it will, positive sign will be there. And when we can change the variables in the definite integral, we have 0 to a ft dt, so we can replace t by x and dt by dx. So 0 to a fx dx, which is equal to left hand side, because we have done, told you the property that the in the definite integral we can change the variable. And the second property I have just told you, that if we interchange the lower limit to upper limit, then the value of the sign of the integral, definite integral, will change. So I'm telling you it again, I've started from the right hand side. I've let a minus x is equal to t, then the dx will be equal to minus dt, so dx is equal to minus dt. When we are changing the variable from x to t, so then we have to change the lower limit and upper limit in terms of t. So what is the upper limit? A minus x is equal to t, we have let it, upper limit is a. When you replace the x by a, the upper limit coming out to be 0. The lower limit, we have let a minus x equal to t, lower limit is 0. When you replace x by 0, the lower limit is coming out to be a. So from it is minus a plus a to 0 ft minus dt, because the value of dx is minus dt. Now when we interchange the lower to upper limit, the sign of the definite integral change, and we can interchange the variable in the definite integral. So in place of t and dt, we can replace x and dx. So these are some properties of the definite integral. Now in the first exercise of this 7.9, it is a very easy exercise. Simply you have to integrate and use the find the definite integral. So simple method is, simply you have to integrate. It is integral from minus 1 to 1, x plus 1 with respect to x. So integral of x plus 1 is x square upon 2 plus x, and you have to find its limit. First of all, you find the value of the function for the upper limit, that is 1 square upon 2 plus 1. Replace the value of x by 1. This is the upper limit. Minus sign is there because I've just told you that definite integrally fb minus fa, upper limit, lower limit. So replace f, first of all find fb, that is replace x by 1, so 1 square upon 2 plus 1, minus replace the value of x by minus 1, that is minus 1 square upon 2 plus minus 1. So it is simplified, you are getting the value of this definite integral as 2. Similarly, we have a definite integral from 2 to 3, 1 upon x with respect to x. Its integral is log x, modulus of x. Now upper limit is 3, replace x by 3. Lower limit is 2, replace x by 2. And upper limit minus lower limit, that is log 3 minus log 2. And it is log 3 upon 2 by using the property of the log. Again, we have definite integral from 1 to 2. It is a polynomial, 4x cube minus 5x square plus 6x plus 9 with respect to x. So integrate it. The integral of x cube is x to the power 4 upon 4. That is x to the power 4. For x cube upon 3, x square upon 2 and 9x. Simply replace the value of x by 2 for the upper limit. Minus sign will be there. Replace the value of the x by lower limit, that is 1. So upper limit minus lower limit. Simplify, you will get the value of this definite integral. Now we have sine 2x with respect to x, 0 to pi by 2. So integral of sine 2x, you know it. It is minus cos 2x upon 2. Integral of sine is minus cos 2x and divided by the derivative of 2x, which is 2. Then upper limit minus lower limit. Take half outside this bracket. So replace x by upper limit, which is pi by 2. So cos pi minus lower limit is 0. So cos 0, so upper, cos pi is minus 1 and cos 0 is minus 1. So it is coming out to be minus 1. In question number 5, cos 2x, same as question number 4, integration of cos 2x is sine 2x upon 2, upper limit minus lower limit, replace the x by upper limit, that is pi by 2, that is sine pi, lower limit is 0, that is sine 0, sine pi is 0, cos 0 is sine 0 is 0, so the value of this integral is 0. Then definite integral from 4 to 5, e raised to power x with respect to x. So first of all, integrate e to the power x. The integration of e to the power x is e to the power x. Then lower limit is 4, upper limit is 5. Replace the upper limit, x by upper limit, that is e to the power 5 minus e to the power 4. So like this, you can integrate or find the definite integral in the definite integration exercise, that is 7.9. We'll discuss in the next lecture. Thank you.